we'll be talking about capillary exchange and various factors that's going to affect capillary exchange. So what is capillary exchange? Capillary exchange is basically talking about what kind of materials is going to enter or leave the capillaries. And if this is the capillaries, then the surrounding is going to be the tissue. So we'll put tissue here, and it could be any kind of tissue. It could be at the kidneys, it could be at the liver, so on and so forth. Okay, and so what dictates which way material is going to move? So the easiest one to understand is diffusion. Okay, so as you learned previously, diffusion is the movement of material from an area of high concentration to an area of low concentration. Right. So if this is a capillary, it's possible that you are going to have more oxygen inside the blood vessels than you do in the tissue. And so by simple diffusion, the oxygen molecules is just going to move out of the capillaries. So similarly, if there are more carbon dioxide on the outside compared to the inside, then just by diffusion, it's going to move into the capillaries. So some materials, the only thing that governs the direction of movement across the capillary beds is just the relative concentration inside the blood vessels compared to the outside. So in addition, there are two other factors that's going to decide which way things are going to move. And to make things a little bit more simpler, we are just going to look at the movement of fluids. So previously, we did talk about the fact that capillaries are quite leaky by nature. So fluid is going to be able to move in and out of the capillaries depending on the next two factors that we will be talking about. So the first, the second factor is blood pressure. As you all know, the blood pressure inside a blood vessels is going to be highest when it's closer to the heart. So if you think back on the graph that we talked about in lectures, the blood pressure is going to be the highest in the arteries, and then it's going to decrease when we get to the capillaries, and then it's going to be the lowest in the veins. So if this piece of blood vessels here represent a capillaries, we can say that this is the arterial side, which means it's connected to, say, an arterial, and then previously to an arteries, and on this side is what we call the venous side. So it's going to be connected to a venule and then to a vein. And based on your understanding of blood pressure, you will know that the pressure here is going to be higher than the venous side. So roughly speaking, the blood pressure on the arterial side is approximately 30 mmHg. Okay, and by the time you get to the venous side, the blood pressure is going to be about half of that, let's say 15 mmHg. All right, so what does this mean? Well, if you have a higher pressure on the inside of the blood vessels, then it's going to be forcing fluid out of the blood vessels. Okay, but that driving force is going to diminish as you go towards the venous side, just because the blood pressure is dropping. So in general, blood pressure is always going to be the driving force that pushes fluid out of the capillaries. Okay, so that's an important point. Blood pressure causes fluid to leave the capillaries. Now there's a third factor. The third factor is what we call osmotic pressure. Okay, so in a simple sense, osmotic pressure is caused by the amount of dissolved material that you have in the blood vessels relative to the tissue. Right? So it's basically determined by how much solute you have in your blood vessels. So what kind of solute do we normally find in blood? There are proteins, there are electrolytes such as sodium, potassium, so on and so forth. And all these things are going to cause fluid to be drawn into your capillaries. Okay, so that doesn't change. I mean, the amount of proteins you have on the arterial side of a blood vessels is pretty much the same as the amount of proteins you would have on the venous side. So consistently, you would have the same osmotic pressure throughout the entire length of your capillaries. So just to put some number for comparison, that's approximately 21 mmHg. Okay, so 21 mmHg. So just to recap quickly, blood pressure is always going to be causing fluids to leave the capillaries. However, osmotic pressure is always going to be causing fluids to be drawn into the blood vessels. So if you're thinking blood pressure is essentially doing the opposite thing as osmotic pressure, you would be right. So let's take a look at the arterial side. On the arterial side, the blood pressure, which is 30, is greater than the osmotic pressure, which is 21. So overall, you would have fluids pretty much leaving the capillaries on the arterial side. However, on the venous side, as you can see, the osmotic pressure is now greater than that of the blood pressure, and so overall fluid is going to re-enter the blood vessels. So this is actually a good mechanism, because you don't want all the fluids to be leaving your capillaries and not returning back into your blood, because otherwise it's going to accumulate in the tissue and that could cause swelling. But you should also note that the amount of fluid that leaves the capillary is actually greater than the amount that re-enters, because the difference in pressure is not exactly the same on both sides. So any fluid, excess fluid, that is left behind in the tissue would then return to the blood through the lymphatic system, which is something that we'll be talking about more in later lectures. So that's it for capillary exchange. I hope you understand a little bit more after watching this video.